struggling with their faith. And that's probably one of the reasons why I do tend to talk a lot about in messages and in conversations, the reality of questioning, the reality of going through times when you might not feel as sure and as certain of your faith, of your walk with Jesus, whatever it may be, and to whatever degree it may be. And sometimes, much to the pain of not only myself, but of fellow brothers and sisters in this church, some people wander away, and they wander off, and maybe they cut off. And there are many reasons for that. And sometimes people come back and they return. Sometimes they don't. But Jesus knew what that was like. And in fact, we see in one of the most, for me, one of the most wonderful passages of Scripture is Jesus' encounter with the disciples here in John 6. I'm just going to give you a little bit of background here. This Jesus is saying these words, and by the way, for sake of time and space, we kind of did a high overview of this dialogue between Jesus and his disciples with the bread of life. But Jesus has just fed the 5,000 in the wilderness. And that was a significant miracle, as you can imagine. Not only was it a miracle on its face, meaning that he fed 5,000 people, and those were just men, by the way, not counting women and children, with a few loaves of bread and a couple of fish. All the crowd knew that what Jesus had done was the fulfillment of what they expected the Messiah to do when he came. And it was to do what Moses did when the wilderness, during the wilderness wanderings, for our first lesson today, Patricia. That when the people were hungry, God provided them heavenly food, the manna. In Hebrew, the word manna is ma'ul, and it literally means what you call this. Because they had no name for it. They had no concept of it. Except that it was this flake-like, honey-like, cracker-like substance that you could eat. And it was available every day, just for that day. And so the thinking was, when the Messiah comes, that's going to be a way we're going to be able to know that this is him, because he's going to feed the people heavenly bread and wilderness. And so John tells us that people wanted to take Jesus by force, and take him to Jerusalem so that he would there start the Holy War. That's when Jesus tells his disciples, get in a boat, go across to the other side, I'll meet you there. Jesus himself goes up to pray, he comes back, walks on the water, because there was a storm at sea. They get into the other side of the lake, and then Jesus has this conversation. Now Jesus, being a master teacher here, is taking something, an event the disciples had just experienced, and now he's going to use it as, once again, a teaching moment. He's going to use the imagery of physical bread, of physical food, and what it means to have spiritual food, which is Jesus himself. And Jesus does it in a way that would leave no doubt about what he's talking about. So much so that the disciples were very upset. I want another kind of textual note here. When John talks about disciples, he's not necessarily talking about the 12. In fact, John usually will focus, he will say the 12 as opposed to the disciples. The meaning is this, that there were lots of people who followed Jesus. The 12 were his closest companions. They were his emissaries, they were his friends, but there were probably 70, maybe 100 people that followed Jesus regularly. At least up to this moment. Because Jesus again says something here that shook their faith, that shook their understanding, that caused these followers of Jesus to question whether or not they were going to keep following, or whether they were going to unfollow. And folks, maybe some of you are in that place right now. You are wondering if you are going to continue to follow. Why should I not follow? What was it that made me follow Jesus in the beginning? I'm not understanding today as much. I'm not feeling as much today. And in John 6 here, we see what I want to suggest to you are three things. Three kind of don't want to call them concepts or ideas, but just three understandings that come out of this dialogue and this moment with Jesus and the disciples, and people having a really hard time really trying to believe in what he's saying and who he is. So if that's you today, and if it's not you, great, praise God. But if it is you today, we start with this. With Jesus, no matter where you are, no matter what you are feeling, no matter what the objective reality looks like, with Jesus, there is always what I call a promise. There is always a promise that he makes. And he says this, I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me shall not hunger, and whoever believes in me shall never thirst. Now, in Greek, it's in the present tense, meaning a continual coming, a continual action. In other words, Jesus is saying this, when you come to me hungry and thirsty, if you keep coming to me, I'm going to fill you. I'm going to quench your spiritual thirst. In John's, this is the first I am statement of Jesus. Jesus seven times in John's gospel says, I am, and then follows up with a metaphor. And each time he does a lesson, he's teaching on what it means for his relationship with us. Well, here again, Jesus is saying, just as physical food feeds you, so do I feed your soul. Now, in Greek, there are two words for life, and you need to hear this. The word in Greek here for life, which I bolded, is the Greek word zoe. And it literally means vitality. It has to do with the quality of life. When my family and I were in Hawaii during the vacation that you so lovingly gave my family on my 20th ordination, anniversary of ordination, I remember laying on the beach with my daughter and my son, and I said to them, this is good, isn't it? You know, sitting on the land on the beach, is his life. And that's the idea here. That's the zoe. The other word in Greek for life is bios, biology, physical life. Jesus is saying here that he wants to give us a quality of life that no one else can give, that no one else can give, that truly feeds the soul. But the question is, do we believe that? And to what extent do we go to him and not to another source of soy that we think is ultimately going to be the answer? And when Jesus says, I'm the bread of life, John tells us that people say, no, you're not. We know who you are. We know your parents. Why do you keep talking about being this bread of life? What are you talking about? And I can imagine his disciples and going up to Jesus and say, amen. So Jesus doubles down. And he says this, John 6:54. Whoever feeds on my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life, and I will raise him up on the last day. What? Whoever eats my flesh and drinks my blood? By the way, cannibalism was just as obnoxious and unholy then as it is now. And in fact, the early Christians got accused of being cannibals because of this passage among others. What Jesus here is, he is pushing. He's saying, okay, if you have trouble with me saying I'm the bread of life, then here's the next part of this truth. You have to feed on me. And in John's gospel, again, Holy Communion is not happening yet, and all the theology and all of our understanding about communion will come to that. What Jesus is saying here is just as we appropriate physical bread and we put it in our mouth and it goes into our bodies and nourishes our physical bowels, so too when we come to Jesus and we read his word and we pray and we eat at his table and we sing his praises, and we give him our struggles and our pain and our joys and celebrations. When we bring our children to be baptized, as we all have the next service, three beautiful children from our church and school who will come through the waters of baptism. When we do that, we are feeding on Jesus. We are given his life. Our spirits are being fed. And just like one meal doesn't take care of our hunger all the time, we keep coming. We keep feeding. Unless we don't. Unless we stop. And that's what some of his disciples did. John 6:6. After this, many of his disciples turned back and no longer walked with him. All right, man, if you're going to talk like this, no way. By the way, some of you can probably remember that when you walked away. Maybe a period in your life that it passed. Or again, maybe you're sitting here this morning thinking, I'm going to give this one more shot, one more time. But many unfollowed Jesus at that moment. And what could it be for us? Maybe it's not because he said, eat my body and drink my blood. Maybe it's because he said, I want you to forgive your enemies. I want you to trust in me more than you trust in your job or in yourself. I want you to be faithful, giving. Your money belongs to me. Your gifts, your skills belong to me. I want you to use those for the glory of me and other people. What is it for us? I was thinking about it this week and mulling it over and thinking, again, just both in my own experience as a person, as a human being, but also as a pastor talking with people. I kind of found out there were generally three events, if you will, where people tend to turn around and walk away from Jesus. One of them is transition. Put them on your notes. It actually gives you space. You want to write down something you're thinking about right now. How many of you remember leaving home and going to college? And finally, you were on your own. And you used to go to church with your family. Maybe you had to go to church with your family. Or maybe you went alone. But now you're in college and no one's checking up on you. And boy, all my friends are still here. Or you move. You move into another city. I can tell you, I've heard this so much. People say, you know, we can't find a church. No place is like, they say Red Hill because it's where they remember, but it could be any church where you were at for a while. Any church where you grew up and try to find another faith community is hard. Or maybe you had a very bad experience in another faith community. Or maybe you were hurt by what someone said, by what a pastor said, by what some people did. And now you're coming into another place, and do you trust in him? Do you give yourself again? Transitions are hard. When relationships are changing, going through divorce, going through separations, just going through trials and conflicts, many people will cut off. That's usually one of the first clues that leads me to call on someone that I haven't seen. And be honest with you, if someone suddenly just stops coming or stops being involved, there's usually one of two things. You're either mad at me or us or the church. Or there's something going on in your life. There's a crisis. And they may feel shame. They may feel like God's let them down. It can be transitions sometimes where we want them to follow Jesus, but there also can be times of trouble. This may be the most common reason. God isn't answering my prayers. I've got all of these doubts. Again, I'm in college, and what was once so easy to believe, I've got professors telling me that everything I believe in the Bible is wrong. And they're using all these theories that sound logical. Well, where's my faith? My faith was so strong, but now I'm starting to doubt. Even my friends are telling me what I believe in fairy tales. Yeah, this person that I work with, this person. know, they're not Christians, and they seem to be enjoying life a lot more than me. Or you know what? I work so hard during the week, I'm so tired. Just sleep in on Sunday. And then 2 Sundays. And 3 Sundays. Or you know what? I know this guy is not a Christian. I know this guy doesn't share my faith, but he's so cute. I know this woman, she doesn't have a clue about what the Bible is, or about what I believe, or about Christianity, but I need a girlfriend. I don't want to be alone. Transition, trouble, temptation can want us to say to Jesus what some of these disciples said. I can't do this anymore. But will we ask the question? Will we ask the question, if you will, or actually better said, will we answer the question that Jesus asks? And here's the question that Jesus asks. So Jesus said to the 12, do you want to go away as well? Now if I was there, if there's one time in the Bible I want to be, it would be there only to see Jesus' face. But again, I always picture this, that Jesus has a tear in his eye, and he goes to the disciples and he said, you're going to leave me too? And Jesus knows what it's like to be left. But it's like to have people who tell you that you are the best thing in the world, the greatest thing that's ever happened, only to turn their back on you and never look at you and speak to you again. Maybe because of the stand you took in faith. Maybe because of what you believe. But Peter's answer is the answer for us as well. And really, in true rabbinic form, Peter's response was another question. John 6, 68, 69. So Peter answered, Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. And we believe and have come to know that you are the Holy One of God. Jesus, look. We were doing fine as fishermen. Things were going well. Things were going okay. But then you came along. And we started following. And yes, it hasn't been easy. And yes, we've had questions. And yes, we tell stories that sometimes go so far south. Like saying, eat my flesh and drink my blood. But you know what? Where else am I going to go? Where else are we going to go once we've tasted? Once we've seen? We know who you are. You are the Holy One God. Friends, that is a statement of faith. It is a statement that recognizes that yes, we have doubts. Yes, we have struggles. Yes, we have transitions and troubles and temptations. But answer the question honestly. You know who Jesus is. You've trusted him in the past. So let me just ask you straight out. If not Jesus, then who? If not Christianity, then what? What will be the belief system? What will be the worldview, if you will, that will define your life? Because walk away from Christianity or not, you will still follow a worldview or a belief system. And if you do, just be aware of what is going to be the destination of this belief system that I'm choosing instead of my Christian faith. Sometimes resetting our faith means just, I'll say it again, taking just another step forward. Not knowing what the future holds, yet knowing who holds the future. But when God gave the manna to the people of Israel, he gave them enough for one day. Because he wanted them to trust him. Because he wanted them to know that what they needed for the day they were going to get, not for tomorrow, the past is past, but for today. Now, I always remember and thought of the manna story as how God deals with all of us every day. If you're afraid today, God's going to give you the courage you need today. If you're hurting today, God's going to give you the comfort that you need today. Yes, we don't know what's going to happen if that person's going to change their mind and But we do hope and we do trust that Jesus is the Holy One of God. So after you've considered the questions and considered the options, when you do, the fog will lift. And you will find the courage and the strength to believe and to experience the faithfulness of God. So today, let's once again reset. Come to the Lord's table today and receive His body and blood, His life for you, His forgiveness for you. And He will walk with you out of this sanctuary into the future that only He knows. Let's pray. Lord, thank you again for your promises, for your encouragement, and Lord, for your patience. Help us now, Lord God, to